Halfaday, I'm not Johnny Cash, I'm Danny No Cash. Here in Afghanistan. Thank you.
Common sense. Sorry.
I think the Pacific Island soldiers contribute more, more of an asset to the United States military, and by far get the least recognized. You know, because when you really think about it, too, you know, the Pacific is really the largest ocean in the world. You know, we have so many islands here, so many nations. What's really sad as well is we end up losing more people. More people from the Pacific die, per capita, than any other state, and that was just so true during the Vietnam War, and even most recently, we just had two soldiers just killed on our deployment within a month after we arrived. And, that really, hurts the community much more than it'll hurt, somewhere else. I mean, over here, you're not a number, when you die, you're a person, you're not a stat, that, John Doe, is the 13th soldier to get killed in Afghanistan. No, there was John Doe here on Guam, his name will appear, and the whole island gets impacted by it. We're not getting the proper recognition for the sacrifices that we do. We're not getting the proper attention for the sacrifices we do. But to some degree, that's our island style. We're very relaxed, very friendly, very comforting. We just sometimes just let that just slip above our heads and don't let that bother us.
You spend any time speaking to a soldier from this part of the world, they're gung-ho. They give it everything they've got when they're downrange and they're at the front. They're not waiting to be told. They take the lead and everywhere we go, as soon as someone hears that I'm from Guam, people always say, "Wow, I'm really impressed because the soldiers from Guam, they really step up." So I think that has a lot to do with our casualty rate, because you're not going to have guys waiting in the back. You're going to have these guys charging, doing what it takes to get the job done. Unfortunately, that means higher casualties because they put themselves in harm's way.
way, mate.
Alright.
My career, actually, I started as a public affairs specialist for the Guam Army National Guard. I was in the Guam Army National Guard from 1993 to 2000. Then I got out, then I moved to California in the early 2000s, 2002. And I got into the California National Guard in 2004. I've been with the California National Guard since then. The great thing about being public affairs is you go everywhere. I mean, there's 600 soldiers here from Task Force Guam stationed in Afghanistan, and we're in like 13 to 15 locations. I'm one of the few guys who's been to everywhere, to been to all 13 to 15 locations, from up north, west, east, south, southwest. I'm one of the very, very few guys who's been able to go out there. And, you know, to get to meet the troops, to get, you know, to do their stories, to get what it is that they're doing. I mean, you know, this is the best job in the military. I've been to Operation Iraqi Freedom twice. And the whole time that I was there, I mean, you know, we had areas where we know we're safe, you know, where we know that it's secured. You know, I mean, you know, we can do our jobs, you know, in this area. But here in Afghanistan, it's just pretty clear that there's no place safe here. I mean, there's no place. Any place here is pretty, you know, it's pretty much a target into terrorism, into something that's going on. There's more insider threats. That's our term that we use, you know, more insider threats, where people are just being able to manipulate themselves into getting into our units, into our coalition units, and doing harm. You know, I mean, that's just running abundantly here. This place is just so much more different and a lot more threatful, and honestly, to me, a lot more dangerous. The same people who work here for their benefit are the ones who've thrown rocks at us. And it's not just even the kids, you know, it's the adults who are throwing things at us. It's a lot of edgy experiences throughout the whole time that I've been here.
My name is Lieutenant Colonel Mike Tuffer. Came to Guam in 1973. Guam's been my home since then. I lived in Wake Island, moved to Guam from Wake Island, so small islands are kind of in my blood. I'm the battalion commander for 1st Battalion, 294th Infantry in Afghanistan, known as Task Force Guam. It is historic because it's the first time that we've deployed this size of a unit. But more importantly, it's the first time we've had to spend this much time as a large unit working together to, you know, develop our capabilities and really learn what we are capable of. We've deployed platoons and company size elements in the past, up to about 180 soldiers. But this deployment, almost 600 soldiers, roughly half of the Guam Army National Guard, obviously that's a significant number of people to pull out of civilian life in Guam. It's people in public service, you know, police officers, firemen, you know, people who work in every facet of society, so the island feels it, especially an island with a population the size of Guam. We have soldiers from the FSM, we have soldiers from Palau, we have soldiers from Yap, all over. You know, they bring a little bit of culture from everywhere they come from. And it is interesting to see how that all comes together, but for the most part, it's very similar. You've got a strong sense of respect, you know, among Pacific Islanders, as well as Guam and the Marianas. our soldiers, they want to be the best. I think that comes from that warrior culture. You know, we want to dominate. But ironically, it's balanced with that respect that we talked about. So they want to dominate, but by the same token, they respect their neighbors and definitely the warrior culture.
Psalm 91 cards.
If nobody has any objections, our chaplain's going to say a little prayer.
Chaplain Ronaldo Pasqua. I'm from Hawaii, actually from the island of Oahu, but I am attached to the Guam Army National Guard, the first of the 294th, also called Task Force Guam. Yes, of course, the goal is peace, and unfortunately, in this world and in life, there is war and conflict. You know, the theological answer, of course, is because of sin, and the effects of sin we see is through war and hatred and killing. How I reconcile that is, as a chaplain, I don't condone those things, but sometimes those things are necessary in order to accomplish peace. And my job as a chaplain here in the Army is to support our soldiers. You know, some of them have that conflict within themselves, and some of them face the fears of dying, not being with their family, fear of engaging the enemy. And so I see my role here as one to strengthen them emotionally and spiritually, which makes up the whole soldier, physical, social, spiritual.
We lost a few soldiers here. And that's that can't be good. There's no good that comes from that. It obviously affected our soldiers, but it's a reality. And one of the things I tried to explain to our some of our leaders immediately following that event is, they were very angry, and they wondered why we were here, why are we doing this mission, why are we putting our soldiers at risk like this. The question I would ask them is, you know, what did they expect? We all knew that that this was a dangerous place, and anybody who thinks that Afghanistan is safe for soldiers or even for the local populace is misled.
I'm Captain Kristen Ramos. I'm the company commander for Foxtrot Company, 1st and 294th Infantry Battalion. I am currently the commander of about 77 soldiers here in the Kandahar region. Our forward operating base is actually a called Kandahar Airfield, or otherwise known as CAF. We're around this area in Kandahar, and it is considered a regional command south, the southern portion of Afghanistan. So seven companies, seven guidons deployed here to Afghanistan around mid-April 2013. We lost two of our battle buddies the earlier part of our deployment. Of course, that will always weigh heavily on us. And I think all of us, regardless of whether or not we knew them, we think of them every day. Specialist Flores and Specialist Uggan, you know, two great soldiers. Gone too soon, definitely. But you know, I think every day we think of them, and we you know want their families to know that you know their lives didn't go in vain, you know we honor them every day and we think of them. We've been exposed to a lot of what we call IDF, indirect fire. Fortunately, this year, knock on wood, we haven't lost anyone actually here in CAF. Due to IDFs, we have in the past, or at least CAF has in the past. The first morning that you were with us, Mr. Bohane, you had the pleasure of having six rocket attacks, four that actually made it here on CAF, but there was actually nine.
We just had a rocket attack. Nothing like a rocket attack while you're inside the shower, you know? I mean, what are you gonna do, man? You can't run out of the shower, you know, naked and everything, you know? So you gotta just finish the shower, you know, and hope for the best. Hopefully nobody got hurt, but hey, wow, you know, Ben hasn't even been here 24 hours and we already have a rocket attack, man. Good job, Ben.
Good job, man.
You've only been in Kandahar not even 24 hours, Ben, and already we're getting two attacks in 5 minutes, man. What's going on here? Yeah. I think that's the all clear. Could you really understand that?